There's nothing more exhilarating than pointing out the shortcomings of others, is there?
This video was made possible due to those who support me on Patreon. I'd like to give a big shout out to patrons Conrad Truitt, Dan Ray, Flake, Joseph Abrams, Kyle Kramer, Logan Cottingham, Majin Weebu, Mariah, Patrick Smith, Sophia Narwitz, and Stephen Dillon. Thank you all for your support.
Listen, you son of a bitch! What the fuck's your problem? You piece of shit? You fucking goddamn fucker? Listen, fuckhead! You have fucking crossed the line. Get that through your goddamn fucking head.
So, yeah, just to make it clear, in case you couldn't tell from my lead-in, I'm not the biggest fan of Spectre. And by not the biggest fan, I mean, not to be hyperbolic here, but I hope every senior creative lead on this project is condemned to whatever ring of hell Benito Mussolini is chilling in. Spectre accomplishes the rare feat of not only being a terrible film in and of itself, but also retroactively causing a torrential rain cloud over the entire saga. The film opens with an admittedly impressive single-shot sequence of Bond pursuing a target in Mexico City. However, despite its technical craft, from a writing perspective, it is a foreboding taste of what is to come. In the opening scene of Casino Royale, the writers do an excellent job of quickly establishing what is going on. In a single line, we know who this guy is and what Bond's intention is. In Skyfall, we quickly establish that Bond and his team are chasing this dude because he has some sort of list. We don't know what the list is, but it is clearly something important since M demands Bond leave behind an injured comrade. In both cases, the goal and stakes are established in an impressively efficient manner. But, Inspector, while we can quickly ascertain that Bond is after this guy, we never get a grasp on what the fuck is going on. At first, I thought Bond was sent to eavesdrop on this meeting to gain information, but then he prepares to kill the dude, which we later learn was what he was seeking to do the entire time. So, in that case, why did Bond even bother listening in on the convo? Because he just so happens to drop a very particular piece of dialogue referring to a man named the Pale King that will be crucial to events moving forward? Probably. Bond fails to kill the dude and pursues him, eventually yeeting his ass out of a helicopter. We are then treated to Sam Smith singing Writings on the Wall. And I don't have much to say about it. It's not particularly bad, but rather meh. I tried to get a sense on where people tend to rank Writings on the Wall next to other Bond themes, and it often comes towards the bottom of the pack. But even their explanation is like, well, it's not bad, it's just meh. The orchestration and vocals are decent enough, but the real question mark is the lyrics. I went over how all three preceding themes of the saga fit their respective films, but writing doesn't really. The title itself doesn't even make any sense. Writing on the Wall is a saying indicating something bad or inevitable will occur, but Spectre's ending is actually the most optimistic of the entire saga. Honestly, if anyone can tell me what the Writing on the Wall is in reference to in this case, I would greatly appreciate it. So yeah, it's not terrible, it's just not thematically resonant, and all around just meh. We pick up with Bond being chewed out by M for his actions in Mexico, which Bond carried out outside of MI6's purview. As Bond is leaving, he meets Max Denbig, I didn't look it up before I started recording the video, head of the new Joint Intelligence Service. See, the subplot of the film involves a merger between MI5 and MI6, which is meant to, you know what, who gives a shit? The subplot is so ass, I am not even gonna waste time on it until it becomes slightly relevant towards the end of the film. Bond makes his way home and runs into Moneypenny, who states,
"Forensics finally released this.
What is it?
It's personal effects they recovered from Skyfall."
Oh! Okay, so despite Skyfall not being an explicit follow-up to Casino Royale and Quantum, Spectre is a direct follow-up from Skyfall? I mean, okay, I thought we were kind of doing away with the whole serialization thing, but I mean, whatever. Hopefully this won't lead to any thematic inconsistencies. Later, Moneypenny arrives at Bond's place and grills him on what he was doing in Mexico. Bond shows her a tape that M recorded before her death, telling him to find and kill a man by the name of Marco Sciarra, and to not miss the funeral. Which is, wait, what? Bond says the tape was left in his mailbox after M's death, but when did she arrange for this to be done? I assume during the events of Skyfall? I mean, okay, but why wouldn't M just tell him with her dying breath or while they were at Skyfall before Silva showed up? I understand this was a shoehorned in plot point in order to generate a conflict for the next film, but you can't just do shit like this when it leads to a bunch of lingering holes in the previous film. Aside from the tape M left for Bond, there is another major issue issue with this scene. Before Bond shows her the tape, Moneypenny says she knows James is up to something, but he keeps it to himself because he doesn't trust anyone. Now see, if Spectre was a standalone film, I could jive with that. But since it has already been established that these events are directly following Skyfall, I most certainly do not jive with that. What do you mean Bond doesn't trust anyone? The finale of Skyfall has Bond trusting Q with the plan to set a trap for Silva. Bond has known Q for a literal hot second and is trusting him to aid him in an off-the-books quasi-kidnapping of the fucking head of MI6. So all that teamwork we see displayed in Skyfall, Bond working with Q, Tanner, and even Mallory to save M, is just sort of erased by a single line. Well, okay, let's just say she didn't know about all that. That's stupid, but let's just say that. Even so, her characterizing Bond as not trusting anyone is completely blown the fuck out less than a minute later when Bond proceeds to ask her to do some digging on the identity of the Pale King. The film is trying to establish that Bond has issues trusting others, but this is negated by the events of Skyfall and the same fucking scene it is established in. The film explicitly states this is a continuation of the previous film, then immediately scrubs out the characterization displayed in that film. Then we see Bond sift through a box of documents recovered from Skyfall. First of all, I don't see so much as a post-it note making it out of this shit. But of course, it's like four pieces of paper that are all related to the plot. One of the pictures is even burnt in such a way to obscure the face of the dude who will later be revealed as the main villain. Who wrote this fucking shit? Bond then visits Q, and there is so much bad in this scene. In Skyfall, Q and Bond's dynamic was very entertaining. Q is not afraid to stand up to and even put Bond in his place. Beyond that, they are shown to work as a strong duo, both showing respect for one another's prowess, and when Bond asks Q to help him, even though it means going beyond the purview of his superiors, Q hardly hesitates. But then Inspector, Q is a little bitch, which is in stark contrast to the quiet confidence he displayed in Skyfall. And then when Bond asks Q to help him disappear so he can continue his quest left by M, Q is so timid, saying like, oh well, I answer to M, I'm not really supposed to do this. In Skyfall, their dynamic was akin to two equals with different expertise working together to get the job done. Inspector, it's Chad and Eugene, with Q only going along with Bond's request because he seems intimidated by him, which he never was in Skyfall. Not only does this neuter Q, but it frames Bond as kind of a dick. Bond was always a rebellious scoundrel, but that was directed towards his superiors, not those he was meant to work with in the field, whom he has always been shown to be respectful of. Here it feels less like he is asking an ally for assistance, and more like he is coercing him. And just to add insult to injury, Bond later steals the Aston Martin prototype, which was meant for 009, showing a lack of respect for both Q and his fellow agent. It's so stupid too, because the only reason Q shows Bond the car, just to tell him it isn't for him, is to set up Bond stealing it. It's such a transparent setup for a mediocre, out-of-character gag. Oh yeah, also, remember this?
Were you expecting an exploding pen? We don't really go in for that anymore.
Oh yeah, by the way, here's an exploding fucking watch.
You.
Bond heads to Rome to attend Sciarra's funeral and chats with his widow, Lucia, later saving her from a pair of goons, which is then followed by an insanely uncomfortable scene of Bond, quote-unquote, seducing her. Lucia calls Bond out for killing her husband because now she has no protection, and Bond starts approaching her, pinning her up against the wall, and, like just think of the context here. Lucia's life is in danger, so the, quote-unquote, seduction comes off as kind of a bit duressy. Also, this is completely unnecessary. Bond seducing Solange was done to get information on her husband. Here, Lucia needs protection, so she most likely would give Bond the info he wants in exchange for safety. So, why do they fuck? Again, it's like the writers were like, we need to have Bond bang at least one chick. That was an argument I proposed as to why they had him and Severine fuck in Skyfall, but Inspector, this doesn't even apply, because he has an entire romantic arc in the latter half of the film. It's hilarious too, because after Lucia gives him the info about the Spectre meeting that night, he just fucks off and says he contacted the US to come and get her. But okay, but how long is that gonna take? There were two guys in her fucking backyard who were about to ice her. What makes you think more goons won't show up before the Americans get to her? Bond, you have a really bad track record of failing to adequately protect the women you get involved with. Really nice to see your development as a character. So Bond attends the meeting, which of course has a cliche bad guy's big ass table set up, where this Hans Landa looking bastard orders the death of the Pale King. We later learn that Bond recognizes him as his former foster brother, Franz Oberhauser. Franny reveals he knows Bond is here, somehow. Bond escapes and is pursued by Franny's goon guard, Drax, in a stupidly long and pointless chase scene. The film borders on 2.5 hours. There is no need for the scene since it is just used as a big exposition dump. It's also fucking dumb because the scene spends a lot of time showing off the car and all its doohickeys and gadgets. Pretty fucking rich considering.
We don't really go in for that anymore.
But that's okay because the point of showing off these features is to set up when they are featured in a later scene, right? You know, classic setup and pay. So Bond learns from Moneypenny that the Pale King is in reference to Mr. White.
Yay!
Who was first introduced in Casino Royale and was last seen escaping from MI6 at the beginning of Quantum. And this is where the film officially implodes on itself. See, by reintroducing Mr. White, this cements that all four films in the Craig saga are sequential, meaning that this Bond, this character we are seeing, has gone through all the events of the previous films. This also means that every single inconsistency in Bond's characterization stands. The gripes I had about Bond's ability to trust people or killing not really having any effect on his personality, yep, they all apply now. Also, Mr. White's reintroduction now reiterates my earlier question, what the ever-loving fuck happened with Quantum? We find out later that Quantum is actually a subsidiary of Spectre, or something. However, this makes no sense because in Quantum, M states that she has no idea about the organization. But at the beginning of Spectre, she tells Bond to hunt down Sciara. So, did she know about the Quantum Spectre thing or not? If M did know about Spectre, then why did she act so clueless about it in Quantum? Maybe she secretly did some digging herself in between Quantum and Spectre, or maybe she was just lying in Quantum and knew all along? But then how does that affect Bond and M's dynamic if she knew his foster brother was the head of a massive criminal organization but never told him? Or if she didn't really know about Franny and his connection with Bond, was it just a coincidence that the organization just so happened to be headed by Bond's fucking foster brother? Bond tracks White down to Austria, where he finds him dying of thallium poisoning. Despite the weight that this scene probably should hold, given the history of Bond and Mr. White, it has absolutely none. Obviously, Bond pushed the trauma of Vesper's death way down deep, but really? He's staring at the man who was responsible for her death straight in the face, and neither he nor White mentions Vesper at all? And it's not like the film is trying to ignore her or something. They could have just made up some random other character to be the Pale King, and everything would be exactly the same. What is even the point of bringing back characters if their past actions and dynamics have no effect on these films' events? Anyway, White asked Bond to protect his daughter in exchange for helping him find Franny, and then shoots himself. Bond heads to see White's daughter, psychiatrist Madeline Swan. Bond informs her of her father's death and asks her for help, but she rebuffs him. He then chills at the bar when Q shows up, telling him to come back to London, and sorry, what the Sam Hill fuck is Q doing here? Well, he's telling Bond to come back to London before Mallory finds out he has gone rogue again. Okay, so why the fuck didn't he just, like, I don't know, call the clinic Bond was at? Like, dude is the head of Q Ranch, and he couldn't contact Bond any other way? And what was even his plan? Like, he got BTFO'd by Bond earlier. Like, did Q actually think he would be able to convince Bond to come back to London? So it turns out that in an earlier version of the script, Q gets captured here and is rescued by Bond in the third act. A henchman gets a drop on Bond, but Q grabs a gun and kills the henchman, saving Bond's life. Bond then recalls their first conversation together about knowing when to pull a trigger in a life or death situation. I can't say how this would have been executed, but at the very least, the scene demonstrates Bond showing concern for Q, which is more in line with his character, and actually leads to a decent character beat for Q, the henchman being his first kill. However, this still doesn't explain why the fuck Q physically went to try and bring Bond back, and in the theatrical cut, it only leads to a lackluster scene where he is being chased by some goons on a ski lift of all things, and easily evades them. While Bond is lay chillin', Madeline gets kidnapped by Bautista and co, leading to a stupidly over-the-top chase scene which offers nothing in terms of plot. The key to chase scenes is that they need to have some end goal or purpose. In Casino Royale, Bond chases the bomb maker, and it ends with him killing the dude and getting his cell phone, which comes into play later. In Skyfall, Bond chases Patrice, which leads to him getting shot and being presumed dead. Something has changed by the end of the chase, whether in terms of plot or character. Here, the chase scene happens right after Bond asks Madeline for her help, but she says no, but then after he rescues her, nothing has changed, but then she says yes. Like, I guess you could say that her almost getting kidnapped by the Spectre goons made her be like, oh, okay, fuck, I'm in danger. You need to protect me. Except this is she knew she was in danger before this chase scene. Like, you could have just gone back before the chase and just have Bond be like, bitch, you're in danger. Like, I'll protect you if you help me. And Madeline's like, you're right, I am in danger. I'll help you. Boom, saved you a fuck ton of money. Bond and Madeline meet up with Q and, oh boy. Okay, I'm gonna try and go slow here. So before he went to save Madeline, Bond gave the Spectre ring to Q to analyze. Oh yeah, by the way, Bond like takes Sciara's like ring off his finger during the opening scene, like in like like they're fumbling in a helicopter and Bond's like, ooh, ring, and why did he do that? Like, he's in a life of the situation. He's like, oh, maybe this, like, random ring on his finger might be important later, so I have to bring it, and I have to make sure I get that before I kill him and kick him out of a helicopter. Okay, sorry. So Q puts the ring on a DNA scanner, which, like, I don't know why. If it belonged to Sciara, wouldn't it just be his DNA? Like, it's been, like, chilling in Bond's pocket for, like, a week. I don't know. And he runs a toxicology report and finds that Sciara's autopsy found evidence of the element Riodite, something like that, which was also found in the tox reports of Silva, Lashif, and Green. Okay, so Q was able to connect all these fuckers to Franny because they just so happened to have traces of the element that the ring was made of in their blood, even though we never saw a single one of these fuckers wearing a Spectre ring. What kind of bullshit attempt to retroactively make it seem like effort was put in to make the films all connected? So after finding out about Spectre and Franny's connection to all the baddies, Bond and Madeline head to Morocco to search a hotel room Mr. White told Bond to find. Bond finds a secret room in the wall and... get her fucking name out of your fucking mouth. Bond finds out where Franny is going, and Madeline wants to come along because she's like, I want to understand what happened to my father. Like, bitch, he got iced by his boss. Not a fucking, like, Hardy Boy mystery. Here is when they try to develop the romance between Bond and Madeline, and it's just so fucking forced. The first real romantic development scene is on the train to Franny when Bond tries to show her how to use a gun. But she already knows how to use a gun because she's not like other girls. Also, her story about hating guns is fucking stupid. She says she hates guns because when she was young, a man came to kill her father, and it is implied, I guess, that she killed the man with a hidden gun under the sink. So, Madeline hates guns because she used one to save her family? Fucking liberal. Then there is a dime store rehash of the dinner train scene with Vesper in Casino Royale. Madeline questions Bond on why he continues to be an assassin. So at least in this scene they touched upon how Bond literally has nothing in his life, which is a callback to, you know, Casino Royale and him trying to find a purpose. But while this may seem like it rings true to what was set up in Casino Royale, the issue is that the film is trying to stuff way too much character development in 15 minutes of screen time. Like, by this time Bond has been an assassin for like years, so like, why all of a sudden is he like, oh yeah, maybe I should like think about retirement and maybe like having kids and finding a wife? Like, why is he thinking about this now? It just, also, they try to do this whole thing where like Bond and Madeline are falling in love, but that's just ridiculous. After falling for Vesper in Casino Royale, Bond decides to leave MI6 behind, but then he is betrayed and she dies, leaving him with severe trauma. He goes on a warpath to find out who killed her, eventually realizing that revenge isn't worth it. He then loses the only sentimental connection in his life, leaving him more embittered apparently, given his characterization at the beginning of Spectre, and the film wants us to believe that this dude just falls in love with some random chick who has only been in the film for 30 minutes? Also, seeing as these films are all sequential, what the hell ever happened to that whole plot point about Bond realizing that the more he kills, the more his soul erodes, and he wanted to leave with what humanity he had left. By this point, he has killed at least, like, what, 4 times as many people? But I guess that doesn't matter and has no effect on Bond's psyche? Vesper's death and betrayal, as well as M's death, leaves no significant impact on Bond's ability to open himself up again? Drax shows up, but Bond and Madeline kick his ass off, and then they fuck. Gosh, who wants to see two people form a mutual love for one another by truly connecting on an emotional level when we can just go with the haha adrenaline makes our pee-pees get hard? Bond and Madeline arrive at Franny's compound, and Franny reveals the big twist, which is that he's actually behind the Nine Eyes program. Oh yeah, I totally skipped over that dumb subplot, didn't I? So MI6 is getting folded into MI5, and Moriarty over here. Oh yeah, I love this too. Gee, who should we cast as our secret bad guy?
Hi.
Plans to introduce Nine Eyes, a massive surveillance program that aims to get rid of the need for 00 agents. And it turns out that they are run by the bad guys. That's literally it. Not super relevant to the plot, really obvious. I guess they just need stuff for the other characters to do for 2 fucking hours. So then Franny delivers what is perhaps the most absurd dialogue in the entire franchise, where he reveals that actually he has been right in front of Bond's eyes all along. Lashif, Green, and Silva were all a part of Spectre, and all the pain and loss Bond has suffered has been a big revenge scheme by Franny.
What do you mean?
Bond got involved with Lashif after MI6 was pursuing a bomb maker in Madagascar. So you're saying that Franny grew up to be a criminal mastermind and his foster brother Bond just so happened to become an MI6 agent and pursue a member of the same organization Franny was ahead of? So this must also mean that he sent Silva after M to try and fuck with Bond? But wasn't Silva's entire characterization about him trying to convince Bond to become his own agent and run his own missions? But now they are saying actually Silva was a part of a massive criminal organization this entire time and directly answered to Franny? Also, what the fuck does Franny even mean that he was the architect of Bond's pain? Vesper was flipped way before Bond was even involved with Lashif. Did Franny just assume he and Vesper would fall in love and thus he could kill Vesper to ensure Bond suffered? Except, isn't the only reason Vesper dies because she made a deal for his life and then killed herself? Like, does Franny think he's playing like 8D chess here or something? I guess I can see him sending Silva after M, but if he only did it to make Bond suffer, why not just have Silva fucking kill her instead of messing with her to make her reflect on her past work with MI6? You're actually retconning Silva's amazingly empathetic motivation to actually it was all just a ruse to get M killed so I could flex on some dipshit I lived with for a while when I was a kid. Like, maybe he's just speaking generally, like not that he actually like orchestrated all this crap intentionally to make Bond suffer, but then this makes all of this even more ridiculous. You're saying every major criminal figure Bond has come into contact with in the last decade works for the same organization which just so happens to be run by his butthurt foster bro? They were so desperate to make it seem like this was all some big serialized saga setting up this big character arc for Bond that they scrambled to slap it together at the finish line, and fucking hell does it show. So Bond gets taken prisoner and is tortured in a stupidly elaborate chair thing. And now of course it's time for the big motive reveal. So when Bond went to stay with Franny after his parents died, he and Franny's father formed a bond, which made Franny here jealous. So Franny does the logical thing and murders his father and fakes his own death, which makes a lot more sense than just murdering Bond. Because if he really wanted his father's attention, like, it wouldn't just make sense to just, you know, kick Bond down a flight of stairs, right? He needs to murder his father, fake his own death, and then take his revenge by setting up an elaborate 30-year plan to fuck with Bond's shit. Not only is this just ridiculous, it also completely demolishes the film's track record of more grounded antagonists. Lashif and Green were simply both criminal entrepreneurs whose businesses were disrupted by Bond. While Silva was sensationalized, this was juxtaposed by how empathetic his motivation was. We as an audience can buy that being betrayed by those you gave so much for and being tortured to the brink of insanity could drive him to this. Not so much with Franny. To think this is something we as an audience could would ever buy is simply absurd. This is some straight Days of Our Lives shit. And just when you think it couldn't get any dumber, Franny here reveals his new identity.
Franzl Bowser died 20 years ago, James, in an avalanche alongside his father. The man you're talking to now, the man inside your head, is Ernst Stavro Blofeld.
For those of you familiar with the classic era Bond films, Ernst Stavro Blofeld is one of the franchise's most prominent recurring villains and has since become an iconic archetype of the diabolical supervillain. His most essential influence on pop culture, of course, being the fact that he was the inspiration for one of cinema's other most iconic villains. The issue with this reveal is twofold. One, the fact that the film is incorporating such iconic elements of the franchise, notably the Spectre organization, as well as employing Blofeld as the main antagonist, makes it seem as though the writers are just getting lazy. This just results in the film becoming a crappy smorgasbord of a bunch of Bond references. Also, the Blofeld reveal runs into the same problem with Moneypenny, which is, unless you know who Blofeld is, it means nothing. Imagine you're in the theater and Franny comes over and reveals himself as Ernst Stavro Blofeld, and half the audience gasps in shock, and you're sitting there like, who the fuck is that? And it's not even as if the reveal means anything to the film anyway. Franny could have been like, my true name is Magugenheimer Bollick or Schmidt, and it would have no impact on literally anything in the film. As much as I would like to believe that this was some set of extraordinary circumstances that resulted in the Spectre script being such a clusterfuck of epic proportions, sort of like how Quantum was hindered by the writer's strike, well, it turns out the reason for its shit quality was just good old lack of creative vision. It's not like they had a completely new writing staff or anything. I honestly just don't think the writers had any coherent idea as to where they wanted to take the franchise. So following the Sony leaks of 2014, a bunch of emails regarding Spectre's development were exposed, which detailed that aside from concerns that the film was running over budget and general frustration by the studio as to how the film was coming together, apparently the third act was an absolute disaster. So after the Blofeld reveal, Bond and Madeline are able to escape by utilizing the exploding watch Q gave to Bond, which injured Blofeld. And then, in an absolutely absurd scene, they escape this massive compound filled with personnel and armed guards in about 60 seconds. Bond guns down just shy of a dozen men while not taking a single shot as he casually strolls right out in the open. Then they make it to the chopper pad, but obviously there is no way they can escape as they will surely be pursued by the likely hundreds of hostiles in the compound. Let's just move on. Bond and Maddie make their way back to London and make contact with M, telling him that Moriarty's actually a baddie.
Oh, what a twist.
And they need to stop the Nine Eyes program from going online. As they leave, Maddie says she can no longer stay with Bond because she doesn't want to go back to that life or whatever, and that she can't ask him to change because this is who he is. So aside from this ringing hollow as fuck because the film is asking us to believe Bond and Maddie are like madly in love despite the fact that they have only spent maybe a few days together tops, but also because, Maddie, what do you mean this is who he is? You hardly know him. What a stupid fucking line right out of the cliche, meaningless yet pretentious dialogue handbook. So Maddie fucks off, and Bond, M, Tanner, Moneypenny, and Q all set out to stop the Nine Eyes project from going online. En route, some Blofeld goons, who somehow knew Bond was back in London and trying to stop the Nine Eyes program from going online, immediately kidnap Bond and bring him to the old MI6 building, which is inexplicably decked out as some twisted funhouse specifically for Bond, taunting him with pictures of his past adversaries and people he cares about, which I guess is supposed to mean something, but really just comes off as the writers trying to imply all of this was connected in some thematic way, when it really, really, really isn't. Bond finds Blofeld, who somehow is able to survive a bomb to the fucking face, as well as his entire compound exploding into a fireball, and of course they had to throw in another reference to the old films by giving Blofeld his fucked up eye. Blofeld tells Bond that they have kidnapped Maddie, and she is being held somewhere in the building, and has 3 minutes, 3 minutes, to find and save her. So just to back up a second, so you're telling me that somehow, in the time it took Bond and Maddie to return to London and contact M to let him know about Blofeld's connection to Nine Eyes, Blofeld, who just got his face scorched and his entire compound incinerated, was somehow able to make it to London roughly at the same time, set up an elaborate funhouse in the old MI6 building, like seriously, did he send a Spectre goon to Kinko's to pull this off, have his eye heal a substantial amount, somehow know that Maddie would part ways with him, kidnap her first, tie her up in the building, and then set Bond loose to find her in some elaborate twisted game? Why would he even do this? If Blofeld's entire point was to torture Bond, why not just kill Maddie in front of him? Why even give him the chance to save her? Well, I mean, maybe that is what he is doing anyway. Like, he only gives Bond 3 minutes to find Maddie in this massive building, so there is no way. Oh, there she is. They escape and pursue Blofeld's chopper in a boat, and Bond is able to shoot them down with a pistol. Awesome. It crashes and Bond confronts the injured Blofeld, holding him at gunpoint. And let's leave it right there for a second. Oh yeah, also Q and M stopped the Nine Eyes program from going live after a pathetically short struggle with Moriarty and with him falling to his death.
Dead.
Wow, thanks Tanner. Did you really have to check his pulse? Yeah, the entire third act is an absolute shit show. It was so bad that fans couldn't believe it. Literally. A major fan theory soon spread that the final act was a hallucination Bond was experiencing while still being held prisoner at Blofeld's compound. I repeat, the final act was so shit, viewers actually theorized that it was all a dream because they couldn't believe something this fucking absurd. The Sony hacks also revealed a number of production notes in regard to the film's script. The consensus being that while the first two acts were fine, which is quite telling considering, as we have already gone over, there is very little fine in them, the notes on the third act were fucking scathing, deeming it a boring and bloated finale. There were some changes that were thankfully made. Apparently, Blofeld was supposed to have a female henchman referred to as a lesbian bad lady who had the hots for Maddie, and you know, I'm not even gonna touch that one. But overall, the general issue of the final act being ridiculously over the top while simultaneously boring as hell remained. And then there is Bond's final choice. Bond holds Blofeld at gunpoint, but decides to spare him, tossing his gun and walking off of Maddie. The implication, I guess, being that he has given up his life as an assassin and has finally found love again. Now, interestingly enough, it turns out that the original ending actually had Bond kill Blofeld on the bridge, but this was changed at some point. One note stating, the killing of Blofeld with a final shot to the head, I don't know, seems pretty brutal for even Bond. Like, as much as I agree with these people on the third act being shit, what even is this note? Bond has killed countless people. He left Green to die in the middle of a desert. Putting that aside, Blofeld stated he had a direct hand in the deaths of the two people Bond cared about most. I think a bullet to the brain seems merciful compared to what Bond probably wanted to do to him. But alas, Bond spares Blofeld because, why? Well, this is supposed to signify he is giving up his life of killing and retaining his humanity. Yeah, but this is fucking absurd. Like, in Casino Royale, Bond states he wants to leave MI6 to retain what is left of his soul so he can love Vesper. But by the time this moment rolls around, Bond has now killed probably, what, like 7 or 8 times as many dudes? To put this in perspective, Bond kills as many people during his, just like that small sequence where he escapes from the compound, than he does in the entirety of Casino Royale. And that is totally excluding however many people died when... So the idea that Bond walking away from killing Blofeld is somehow him sparing his soul is ludicrous. Even so, what is one more death? This isn't even a matter of vengeance. Keeping him alive only puts everyone Bond still cares for in danger. Gee, I hope keeping him alive doesn't bite him in the ass somewhere down the line. Perhaps it was his love for Madeline that inspires him to leave MI6, thus making sparing Blofeld more symbolic? But again, that's kind of stupid considering Bond hardly knows this woman. We are supposed to buy that he is so in love that he is able to overcome his trauma in the blink of an eye? What was the point of revisiting the immense impact Vesper's betrayal and death had on him if you were just going to hand wave it? I could see Bond getting over his trauma and moving on, of course, but this needs to be developed. Instead, it is jam-packed into the final hour of the film. Thus, instead of being emotionally resonant, it is just insanely contrived. In those Sony leaks, there was a script note sent by co-president of production at Columbia Pictures that perfectly summarizes my own personal critique of the finale. If this is the movie that resolves the last three films, then the emotional significance of that idea for Bond seems only lightly served at best. He finds the Vesper tape, but never watches it. He appears to fall in love again for the first time since Vesper, but there's no real emotional vulnerability there. Why this girl? Why now? When he leaves with her at the end of the movie and throws his gun in the river, has he gone for good? Or is this just a well-earned vacation, as is so often the ending of a Bond film? Does he feel some sense of completion that he finished the last mission M/Judy left for him? It's hard to know what significance any of these final gestures carry. On fucking point. This was, almost verbatim, the exact same problem I had with the ending of Quantum. The ending insists that Bond has undergone some emotional arc, but it isn't even really clear as to what even the hell. So, in summary, Spectre not only ties all the films together in an insanely sloppy and shoehorned in manner, which offers no plus side, but results in numerous continuity issues in regard to both plot and characterization, demolishes any sense of consistent characterization when it comes to Bond, and ends with an absolutely horrendous third act, which is capped off by a confounding and empty finale. Like, honestly, I could end this video right here. Spectre did so much damage to the saga, corrupting it beyond repair, that there is no possible way anything could bring it back at this point. However, is there a chance that it can be salvaged? Can the damage be reversed? Is there hope that one last film can save the day? No. No, there is not. However, to be fair, I actually think No Time to Die, while flawed, does a surprisingly admirable job of trying to bring the series to a satisfying end. It doesn't succeed, but I give it credit for trying to make sense of what is an extremely uneven and confounding saga. The film opened with a flashback to the death of Maddie's mother by a mysterious masked man. Maddie shoots the man, but ends up running and falling into a frozen lake, only to be saved by her mother's killer. As refreshing as it was to not open with a standard Bond action scene, we're only 5 minutes into the film and we're already retconning shit. This event appears to be a callback to when Maddie speaks of the time a man came to her home to kill her father. The issue is that this doesn't really match up, like the stories don't really mesh at all. Like, the only thing Maddie tells Bond is that she hates guns because a man came to kill her father but didn't know there was a gun under the sink. So let me know if I am off base here, but the implication was that Maddie shot and killed the man and it scarred her, right? Okay, but then we discover the dude killed her mother, and then she didn't even kill the dude with the gun. So, like, wouldn't it have made more sense for her to say she hates guns because, like, I don't know, she had to listen to her mother get gunned down? Again, I understand it is a retcon, but why make this scene connect back to Madeline's story if the scene doesn't even match up to the fucking story? We then cut to Bond and Maddie lay chilling in Italy, following the events of Spectre. Maddie urges Bond to go to Vesper's grave and finally make peace with her betrayal. Which is strange, because I thought the implication of Quantum's ending was that he let go of Vesper and regained the ability to trust others, but now I guess not. The next day, Bond visits Vesper's grave. It's actually amazing how such a short scene can communicate so much by allowing Craig's performance to speak for itself. As much as I felt the trauma of Vesper's betrayal wasn't properly present throughout the rest of the saga, I do give the film credit for offering this reconciliation. It truly is a lovely moment. That is, until...
Ouch, town population, you bro!
Bond rushes from Vesper's grave to protect Maddie, as it appears Spectre has found him. But on his way back, he learns from a Spectre goon that Maddie has set him up. This is further supported when Maddie gets a phone call from Blofeld, confirming that she is working with Spectre and tried to have Bond killed. After a pretty sweet action set piece, Bond puts Maddie on a train, telling her she will never see him again. So, okay, I understand why the writers set this up, since Spectre left zero conflict to play with for the next entry, so they had to do something to set events into motion. The issue is that this entire turn makes absolutely no sense. So it's strongly implied that Bond truly thinks Maddie betrays him. Except this is just, like, ridiculous. When he gets back to the hotel room, Bond is like,
How did they know I was here?
Wait, who? Spectre? That massive criminal organization who was established as having hundreds of operatives all across the globe and was engaged in a massive surveillance operation? Gee, I don't know, Bond. How could they know where you were? I mean, she must have betrayed you. Is it really that hard to believe that maybe Spectre has been keeping tabs on you since you busted the head of their organization? And then there is the phone call that Maddie receives from Blofeld. I get the phone call in and of itself would be pretty implicating, but when you take into account that Blofeld straight up tells Bond and Spectre he was purposely sabotaging his romantic and personal relationships, like, hey Bond, like, you know, maybe Blofeld is purposely trying to make it seem like Maddie is fucking you over to mess with you? Also, did you forget that Maddie was tied to a chair in a building rigged to blow at the end of the last film? You think this is all a long con, like sending you to Maddie, you falling in love with her, and then deciding to retire with her? Now, one could argue that Bond's traumatic past has taken such a devastating toll on his ability to trust others that this is why, despite the fact that maybe Blofeld really is just fucking with him, he really believes that Madeline has betrayed him. But if he were this paranoid, how the hell would he have been able to fall for her in the first place? This is the fastest transition from Hey Baby to Bye Felicia I've ever seen. Bond and Maddie part ways, and then we are treated to Billie Eilish singing the film's titular theme. I'll be honest, I love Billie, but when I first heard she would be doing the next Bond theme, I was pretty hesitant, but I'm pleased to report the theme is fantastic. It is the most somber of the five themes, yet both the tone and lyrics perfectly encapsulate Bond's mood, him feeling as though he has been betrayed once again. The film jumps ahead 5 years. Ooh, sorry, wrong transition. Scientist Valdo Obruchev is kidnapped from an MI6 lab. We learn he is working with M to develop Project Heracles, which involves using nanobots to assassinate individuals based on their DNA profile. The set piece itself is excellent, and while the action sequences in the previous films were by no means of poor quality, I think it speaks to the skill of director Cary Joji Fukunaga that the action in this film is able to set itself apart. As for the whole nanobot plot, we'll discuss that a little later. So we pick up with Bond having retired to Jamaica, and he seems to be doing pretty good, which I don't know how I feel about. I praised the similar sequence in Skyfall after Bond fucks off following his brush with death because of how it communicated Bond's mental state efficiently and without dialogue. Here, I can't get a read on him at all. He seems to be doing pretty well for a man who resigned himself to a life of solitude after losing everyone he ever had an emotional attachment to. Like, I would have expected him to be in worse shape, you know? Also, this brings up the question as to why and how Bond ended up leaving MI6. While the end of Spectre doesn't make it clear as to whether Bond is just taking a break or retiring from MI6, in either case, after he ends things with Maddie, Why does he not go back to MI6? Was just the final straw? Was he just over this line of work? But if so, why? This really bugs me since the entire thematic note of Bond being lost without something to live for is so important to the series. It's explicitly demonstrated without something else, he falls into melancholy and depression. So why is it that after breaking things off with Maddie, he decides it's time to walk away from MI6 entirely? If this really was him just completely giving up on having any sort of purpose or drive in his life, again, you'd expect him to be in a pretty dark and gloomy place, right? But as we see, he seems fine. Like, hell, he even sort of seems pretty content. It seems like the writers want particular plot beats, but didn't really give any thought as to how this would affect him in terms of his disposition. So far, No Time to Die is drifting away from the more character-driven storytelling that made Casino Royale and Skyfall such excellent films. Bond is then contacted by his brother from Langley, Felix Leiter. It was nice to see Felix again, seeing as Jeffrey Wright, is a joy no matter what film he's in. Felix asks Bond to travel to Cuba and retrieve Obruchev on behalf of the CIA. Bond declines, but is then approached by Nomi, the new 007, who tells him to let MI6 take Obruchev in. Inevitably, there was some controversy, if you can call it that, leading up to the film's release about Lashana Lynch being cast, mostly of the "the remote culture is ruining my movie film" variety. But this is why it is important to wait until the film is actually released before shooting off dumbass hot takes, seeing as their dynamic is a highlight of the film. A seasoned veteran and a cocky newbie butting heads, only to earn each other's respect and work together as allies. After being told to back off by Nomi, Bond reconsiders his initial choice and takes Felix's offer to head to Cuba. But I really don't understand what makes him change his mind. Obviously, it's implied to be Nomi telling him to back off, and that her being the new 007 bruises his ego, but this doesn't really ring true. If we had some inkling that Bond was lacking fulfillment or satisfaction in his retirement, I could see him take taking Felix's offer. But like I said, Bond seems pretty chill. And seeing as he is the one who walked away from MI6, I don't get why he is so threatened by his title being given to someone else. Also consider, he is setting off on this mission for the CIA, not MI6. Even if I buy that he is peeved about losing his former title, would that really drive him to act against his former organization? Especially considering that Bond's last run-in with the CIA was them putting a capture or kill order on him. Why would Bond be willing to help them get their hands on a scientist with ties to Spectre when they haven't proved themselves to be the most magnanimous in their motives? There is the phone call to M he makes where he questions what the hell M is up to in trying to get a hold of Gorbachev given his connection to Spectre, so maybe part of Bond's drive is to foil whatever Spectre might be planning with Gorbachev. But if Bond is so concerned about Spectre, why the fuck did he retire? He didn't really seem all that concerned about them over the last 5 years, right? When he decides to return to MI6 after M's office is destroyed in Skyfall, we understand his motivation completely based off his previous characterization. Here, not so much. So Bond heads to Cuba and makes contact with CIA newbie Paloma. Paloma was a nice change of pace, and the dynamic between her and Bond was a lot of fun. The saga, and really franchise, had sort of fallen into the brooding, mysterious woman trope when it comes to most Bond girls, but here we see a more light and fun vibe, which was very welcoming, and their action scene together was pretty solid. Bond and Paloma crash a birthday party for Blofeld, attended by the entirety of Spectre, cause that's a good idea. As it turns out, while Blofeld is in prison, he's using a bionic eye to stay up to date with Spectre's operations. And I'm sorry, what the fuck? You're telling me that MI6 didn't know he was rocking a bionic eye for 5 years? Spectre honestly already jumped the shark, but I was hoping the final film in the saga would return to a more grounded, realistic vibe, but I guess not. Blofeld attempts to assassinate Bond using the Neo technology, but Gorbachev switches the DNA profile to the members of Spectre, killing every single member in one big swoop. Which, I mean, it's a bit of a lackluster end to an organization that was built up like a motherfucker, but I guess I give it points for resolving the plotline. So Spectre is done, and after a face-off with stock goons and dealing with Domi, Bond brings Gorbachev to Felix. And things get a little messy here. So Gorbachev has been working for a man by the name of Safin. We'll get to him shortly. He allowed himself to get captured by Spectre, so I assume Safin could get rid of Spectre at Blofeld's party. It also seems that Bond was part of the plan all along too, since Felix's colleague Logan Ash is also working for Safin. So Ash must have somehow incited the CIA to recruit Bond so he would go to the party, and thus when Blofeld tries to kill Bond, Gorbachev is able to switch to vials and kill Spectre. But that means that Spectre knew Bond would be there, but how did they know? So did Ash tell them? Was Ash a double agent for Spectre? Or rather, a triple agent for the CIA? Like, Remember when I said it's best to keep the plotting simple when it comes to Bond films? Yeah, this is what I was talking about. Ash's betrayal is revealed and he shoots Felix before blowing up the ship and escaping with Gorbachev. This is where Felix and Bond share their final moments together. It's a pretty effective scene. However, given that Bond and Felix's relationship over the saga wasn't really developed all that much, this unfortunately rings hollow. When you consider just how little these two have interacted over the saga, it doesn't earn the emotional impact the scene is insisting it's having. Now with the motivation to avenge Felix, Bond returns to MI6 to discover who was behind Spectre's demise. He meets with M, and we learn that in fact he did not resign from MI6 in Spectre. Or maybe he did? Like, M mentions that Bond quote-unquote left MI6, but then that they thought he was dead, so I can't really tell if Bond officially resigned, or he was just taking a vacation. This may seem menial, but it's actually crucial, seeing that if Bond did not resign from MI6 at the end of Spectre, it undermines the entire finale. He spares Blofeld and walks off with Maddie, but not to a regular life, he's just taking a vacation before he goes back to popping heads. Bond confronts M about his involvement in Project Heracles. Aside from the fact that the whole nanobot thing seems too far-fetched for the Craig saga, the writers really threw M under the bus here. In Skyfall, Mallory was introduced as a stodgy office prick, but showed courage when the shit went down. And Spectre, while he is initially at the mercy of his superiors, he is not afraid to get his hands and sturdy when it comes to defending what he believes in. In No Time to Die, he is pretty much just reverted to the stodgy office prick. I can see how, given his own experience in the field, he would be open to the possibility of being able to take out targets without risking the lives of agents or civilians, but it seems super obvious that using nanobot tech to target people based on their DNA, like even saying it, you can see how out of hand that could get, right? But it seems strange that M, based on his established characterization, would even entertain something like this. I could see an out-of-touch office stiff pulling this, but not an ex-soldier. Even his explanation to Bond rings false, as if it could have been touted by any other random character. Bond and Moneypenny visit Q at home to get info on Heracles. They still frame Q as too much of a Eugene for my taste, but at least it isn't as egregious as Inspector, and Q's decision to go over M's head feels less like he is being bullied by Chad Bond, and more like he did in Skyfall, where he is willing to surpass his superiors if it means getting the job done. Q discovers that someone has been collecting DNA of millions across the world. Bond says they need to speak to Blofeld to find out who is behind it, but Q and Moneypenny tell him that only one person has access.
Guess who?
Clearly the film needs to reincorporate Maddie somehow, but this is just ridiculous. I couldn't ascertain if Maddie was meant to be Blofeld's psychiatrist, but I can see the benefit of MI6 allowing them to speak at all, considering their history. Before we begin, we need to ascertain if there are any factors that might compromise your judgment when speaking to Blofeld. Let me see. He poisoned my father, tried to kidnap me, showed me a video of my father blowing his brains out, made me watch the man I love get tortured, almost blew my ass up, convinced the man I love I actually betrayed him, causing him to abandon me, but no, not really. It's also revealed Bond did in fact contact MI6 to warn them about Maddie, but they checked her out and she was clean. But like really? Like Bond contacts you and says, hey, she tried to have me killed, and y'all are like, yeah, I mean, we checked her out though and everything seems normal. Like, why even roll the dice on this? Like, do you think Bond just abandoned her for some irrational reason? I mean, he did, but they don't know that.
How did they know I was here?
Daddy, chill.
So Maddie, who has relocated her practice to London, is visited by Big Batty Safin, who was the man who killed her mother and saved her life in the opening scene. He threatens Maddie to get her to wear a nanobot-scented perfume and visit Blofeld in an attempt to kill him. Maddie and Bond end up speaking to Blofeld together, for some reason, seemed like a bad idea considering Bond still believes she tried to have him killed, but okay. Blofeld comes out in his modified stair-climber chair, and this is where things get really, really, really silly. Madeline has the perfume on her wrist, right? So as Blofeld is coming out, she changes her mind, but of course Bond grabs her wrist, which transfers the nanobots to him. Blofeld comes out and Bond questions him about what happened in Cuba, but Blofeld instead taunts Bond, telling him that actually, Maddie had nothing to do with the ambush in Italy. This is the moment where Bond realizes that he has been duped and Maddie did not in fact betray him. The only question I have is, why does Bond believe him? When Blofeld tells Bond that Maddie didn't betray him, what makes Bond think he's telling the truth? Like, what makes him think he isn't just fucking with him again? What if he is just saying Maddie is innocent to get him to trust her again so she can betray him later? And come to think of it, why would Blofeld even admit it? If what he says is true, and he wanted to torture Bond by giving him an empty life, as he says, why would he tell Bond that Maddie is innocent? Doesn't that allow for the possibility for Bond to rekindle his relationship with her? You know, which he does? Anyway, Blofeld admits Madeline is innocent, for no reason, and Bond believes him, for no reason, and this results in Bond grabbing Blofeld by the throat, thus transferring the nanobots into Blofeld. Also, the same guy who missed the fact that Blofeld had a robotic eye must have been the same guy who decided to put a massive opening in the front of Blofeld's cage, which kinda defeats the purpose, doesn't it? This in turn results in Blofeld dying when the nanobots infect him. However, this now begs the question as to what the original plan was with Madeline. Bond only ended up infecting Blofeld because he lost his composure and grabbed him by the neck. So what was Maddie supposed to do? Wouldn't it have been a bit suspicious if she randomly touches him and then he kills over like 10 seconds later? Like, I assume it has to be spread physically, which is why Blofeld didn't die until Bond grabbed him, right? Despite my gripes, I actually was enjoying the film up until this point, but this is where my suspension of disbelief just went out the fucking window. After Blofeld's death, the team puts two and two together that Maddie must have spread the nanobots nanobots to Bond. Bond then heads to Maya's childhood home in Norway to confront her. Despite the previous sequence being absolute crap, the following segment really returns the saga to its focus on character and emotional resonance. Bond and Maddie speak candidly for the first time in 5 years. It is a bit of a whiplash, with Bond thinking she is a Spectre agent to now just being completely chill with her, but Craig's performance in the scene is exquisite. While not saying much, he seems to reflect on his nature, his difficulties with trust, all without ever explicitly communicating it, really channeling Skyfall in the sense that so much is said with so few words. And it is here that we meet Matilda, Maddie's daughter. Maddie tells Bond she isn't his child, which seems odd, like maybe she wanted him to slowly learn the truth. I don't really know, like I don't think this was meant to be a twist or anything, since it's like super obvious based on her age that she is Bond's, but whatever. Unfortunately, we don't get to see all that much of Bond and Matilda interacting, but the short scene where Bond makes her breakfast is just so damn good in its simplicity. Bond's icy exterior melting away for a brief moment of sincerity. In retrospect, giving Bond a child is rather brilliant, considering his entire character is built around him struggling to trust others given his nature and his trauma, as he always feels they will either betray or leave him. But here, in the presence of a child, Bond is able to be his complete self around her simply because he knows she is a complete innocent. It's moments like this that really made the Craig saga something special, and it's a shame we didn't see more of them. Bond learns that Ash and co are coming for Maddie, so the three of them hightail it to make their escape, leading to a confrontation in the Norwegian wilderness. While I think all the action set pieces in the film are excellent, this one really takes the cake. Bond uses stealth, as well as his intelligence and quick thinking, to come out on top, as opposed to just strong-arming his way through with a barrage of bullets. Despite killing Ash, Maddie and Matilda are taken by Safin. We then come to the final segment of the film, where Bond and Nomi infiltrate Safin's island base to save Maddie and Matilda. Bond ends up meeting with Safin face to face, and we learn that Safin's big master plan is, well, honestly, I wasn't even sure when I first saw the film. There's a whole scene where he is seemingly explaining it, but I didn't even really pick up on it. Like, even rewatching it, like, it's kind of vague. I combed through some Reddit threads, and the consensus is that most people aren't even really all that clear on what the hell he was even doing at the end. Like, he either wanted to use the technology to kill millions of people just to cause chaos, or maybe he was trying to pull a Thanos and wanted the world to be improved by trimming the population. Maybe he was planning on selling the nanotechnology to others, but that seems really silly, considering it may lead to it being used for selfish purposes. And Safin goes on a lot about being a god, so I doubt he'd let others play with his toys, right? Basically, it just gets chalked up to him being insane, which is just really dumb. Like, Silva was insane, but both the reason for and expression of his insanity make sense given the circumstances. Safin goes insane because his family was killed, that's clear enough, and then wanting revenge on Spectre makes sense, but how does potentially killing millions of innocent people track with this? As someone who was driven mad by the loss of those he loves, why would he then seek to inflict that pain on others? Suffice to say, I don't think much effort was put into Safin's character or motivation, which is a shame as it's a total waste of Rami. So Safin ends up escaping with Matilda, and then Bond and Maddie go to save her, but then Safin just lets the girl go. There's not much to say about this little tidbit. It's just really weird. Bond and Nomi are able to get them to safety, but other nations are after Project Heracles. Bond resolves to open the blast doors on the island bunker and call in an airstrike to destroy the lab entirely. Bond stays behind, fighting his way to the control room in a fucking badass single shot sequence where, unlike Inspector, we actually know what is at stake here. He opens the doors, but then while making his escape, the doors are closed, and on his way back, he is confronted by Safin. Wait, wasn't he leaving? Like, even if he did come back to open the doors, why would he do it himself, risking his own life? Anyway, Bond subdues him, but not before Safin is able to infect Bond with nanobots coded to Maddie and Matilda, meaning if Bond comes into contact with either of them, they will be killed. Bond kills Safin and reopens the doors, resigning himself to death as he will never be able to be with those he loves. Bond shares a final goodbye with the woman he loves, her confirming that Matilda is in fact his daughter before the missiles strike and Bond is killed. Now, on one hand, I do appreciate the poetic irony of Bond, who had kept those around him at a distance, now unable to be with the ones he loves. But on the other, yeah, I know Q said there was no way to rid Bond of the nanobots, but you're not even going to try? Like, Bond, you could at least get off the island and give it a shot, right? Even if it takes a fucking decade of research, there's still a chance you'll be able to live your life with your daughter. And hell, you can still chill with them on Zoom and shit in the meantime. However, I guess you could say that Bond having to go back to close the doors resulted in him not having enough time to escape the island. But then that makes the entire thing with the nanobots completely pointless. Looking back, the script definitely needed some brush-ups to flesh out characterization, motivation, but all in all, despite the myriad of flaws I discussed, I still look at the film in a somewhat favorable light. Nowhere near the quality of Casino Royale or Skyfall, but not as down bad as Quantum and Spectre. Like I said, the action was quality, I was glad they decided to return to a more emotional throughline, and despite its flaws, the ending does do a decent job of giving Bond a respectful send-off. I really was surprised they decided to kill Bond off, but giving Bond a daughter made the end so bittersweet and satisfying. Since the beginning of the saga, Bond has been searching for something to live for, to give his life purpose beyond his profession, and with Matilda, he has found it. While the film ends with Bond's death, it is comforting to know that his memory will live on among his colleagues, the woman he loves, and of course, his daughter. Said memory being defined not by his status as a hired gun, a rogue agent, a killer, but the man he truly was underneath his icy exterior, who desired friendship, love, and connection. In the end, instead of taking a life, he sacrifices his own to save the world. However, when putting the film into the context of the entire saga, it just simply isn't able to redeem it. Let me stress, while there are plenty of things to criticize No Time to Die for on its own merits, a lot of its flaws come from trying to course correct shit that was already broken come the final chapter. Bond's consistency when it comes to his capability to trust and work with others is all over the fucking place. The entire theme of killing having a devastating impact on his psyche gets flat out dropped. Inconsistent characterization and dynamics, retcons that result in primary motivations becoming warped, and actions by characters making no sense. Individually, the saga reached heights I would have never thought possible for this franchise from a storytelling perspective. But as a whole, put simply, it is an absolute disaster. To conclude, I want to stress that had this been a case of shooting for the moon but coming up short, had the serialized story arc of Bond ultimately been an admirable yet failed experiment, a valiant effort by a group of passionate individuals, I would have admired said effort. While it is important to point out when a story comes up short, writers trying something new is how the medium gets pushed forward. But this isn't that. Ultimately, the Craig saga did not fail due to its reach exceeding its grasp. It failed due to a lack of coherent vision, until eventually it became a parody of itself, trying to retroactively capitalize on the amazing possibilities that serialized storytelling can offer without respecting the time, effort, and courage it takes to reap its benefits. Which in turn brings us to the real tragedy in all of this. The fact that there was one person in this whole shabakal whose passion for this project did shine through, and that was Daniel Craig. To revisit the introduction of this video, looking back, it is easy to forget just how much pressure was on Craig when he was offered the role of James Bond. He was even initially hesitant due to the enormous weight of being handed the torch of one of the most legendary roles in pop culture history. All the crap people threw at him, people giving him shit about his hair color, his height, and he shut them all the fuck up. When I first saw Casino Royale in 2006, I don't think I even knew who the fuck Craig was. He was just James Bond. Not being familiar with the franchise at all, he was my James Bond, and holds a special place in my memory because of that. The same way that Connery, Niven, I'll never leave you at Holmes, Lazenby, Moore, Dalton, and Brosnan do for others. It really wasn't until I saw Craig and other stuff he would go on to do that I appreciated just how much he embodied the character, how much he understood Bond, and how despite being a fan of the franchise himself, he desired to bring a level of emotional depth to the character never seen before. Craig has spoken many times about the difficulties and frustration he faced while making the films, the physical toll they took, and the effects that being thrust into the international spotlight had on his personal life. But when it came time to suit up and get the job done, holy fuck did he deliver, always expressing gratitude and humility. And it was sad to see that the higher-ups involved with making these films failed to match his dedication. He gave it all for this role, for the fans, even using his platform to help those in need. And I truly hope that him redefining the character will lead to the next Bond having the courage to continue to push the envelope. It is because of Mr. Daniel Craig that, despite my overall disappointment with the saga, I am glad it exists, if only to see his passion, dedication, and devotion shine through. And with that, I leave you with his parting words during his last day as James Bond.
There's a lot of things said about what I think about these films and all of those, whatever, but I've loved every single second of these movies, and especially this one, because I've got up every morning and I've had the chance to work with you guys, and that has been one of the greatest honors of my life, so...